So would you please give a very warm welcome to Omar Abosh. Omar, welcome. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Timo. Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for having me along with you here today at MSC Hexagon in Madrid. So, in terms of some context for my comments, Paolo gave me a very specific and detailed briefing. He said, Omar, could you come along and talk about your perspective on how the world is changing, what that means about disruption, what it means for digital transformation, and what should we as a Salesforce do about it? So, and by the way, can you do it all in 19 minutes and 36 seconds? So I'm going to be quite quick going through all of this. To my perspective that I'm sharing with you is I've spent 30 plus years at Accenture. In the last few years, I've been the CEO of our comms media and technology business. It's a $9 billion business serving companies from the Vodafones to the Airbuses to the Googles. And before that, I was Accenture's chief strategy officer, responsible for all of our investments in M&A, as well as things like our cybersecurity business. And it's through that lens that I look at the world in terms of the innovation that I got a privilege of seeing through the eyes of our clients in most of the big countries around the planet in many, many industry segments. To try and put into words what I see going on, I'd like to ask you guys a question. How many of you have seen a movie called Gattaca? Okay, so about a quarter of you. So Gattaca is a 1997 movie.
My favorite film.
Oh, you like it? Okay, good. Yeah, so I mean, so Timo will tell you, if you were Ethan Hawke, that was probably better than Jude Law, but not really, because it was a movie about genetics and eugenics, and if you had the right gene pool, you'd get promoted, and if you didn't, you didn't. And it was very exciting, and it was, and Uma Thurman was in it, which was fantastic. But it was basically about the power of our genes. And today you have a technology like CRISPR and Cas9, which many of you will hear more and more about. The thing about it that I'd like to draw your attention to is when we sequenced the first human genome in the year 2000, 2001, it cost something like $2.7 billion. Today, that same technology costs a few hundred dollars. And actually, you can send a saliva swab to a company like 23andMe for £150 and get a whole bunch of analysis on your own genetics. What you're seeing is a logarithmic cost reduction in cost of some of those technologies. So some of the things that were envisioned in Gattaca, people are playing with for real today. There are developers in MIT who write a software code where the output is a genetic sequence for a virus that can be used to ingest into an organism to drive genetic changes in that organism, whether it's to treat congenital blindness or improve fertility of crops or other more nefarious ideas that I'm sure will come into your mind. How many of you have seen Knight Rider? I mean, you need to be a bit older to know about Knight Rider, because there's only a few of the older men in the room. So this was the annoying Hasselhoff guy, and always getting himself obviously into trouble for no reason whatsoever, only so that he could call Kit the car to come and save him. But today you can get your Apple Watch, you can dial up your Nissan Nismo or your Tesla or whatever else, and it can come and help you with its level 3 or 4 or whatever it is, autonomy that you're going to see in this technology over the next few years. How many of you remember a movie called Total Recall? All right. Okay, so do you remember like the original Arnie one? Okay, so Total Recall, had mind implants, and terraforming and mining on Mars. And you'll say, okay, come on, Omar. So that one, we're not doing that one. Well, I don't know how many of you follow Elon Musk, but Elon Musk has a company called Neuralink. I started talking about this back in 2016. And actually, he only came out publicly with what they're doing in Neuralink about a year ago or 10 months ago. And this is a tiny lattice mesh of electrodes to be implanted in the human neocortex to understand at a near neuron level what's going on inside the brain, so that you actually fundamentally reduce the distance between the human and the network, the internet, the computer, because he has a genuine fear of AI, and he thinks the only chance for survival of humanity is a merger between human beings and the internet. And better still, he doesn't believe that we're going to do enough to protect planet Earth, so he thinks we need a plan B, and so he thinks we need to colonize Mars. And again, you'll say, well, what is that all about? Well, you've heard of SpaceX. I mean, SpaceX is a privately funded company, I think bar $1 billion of government funding they took in the early 2000s, that is putting payloads into space. a commercial company, if I'd said to you 20 years ago, a commercial company would be putting things in space without government backing, you'd say you're crazy. But actually, that's what they do today. And you probably saw just yesterday in the news, they exploded a ship on purpose to test the safety features of jettisoning the astronaut pod. And you know, why has he done that? Because he thinks humanity need a plan B. And in fact, he's actually said he wants to die on Mars. And I'm sure he doesn't mean on impact. Because, you know, when there's no atmosphere, it's hard to slow down. You know, that's another person. I mean, I know all of you have seen Star Wars, some of you even for the 42 years of it, and will have enjoyed the droids as much as me and my two boys do. And then if you look at a company like Boston Dynamics, which has gone from Alphabet to SoftBank, I mean, it is amazing technology. And the technology that they're doing with amazing high-caliber precision, you know, the handle robot that runs at like 30 miles an hour on a camber with an icy surface lifting 40-pound loads, I mean, it's really incredible. And that's without machine learning. That's using analytics. So you see incredible advances from one field after another. And then my last one. How many of you have seen a movie called Her? Her, okay. Not so many. Okay, Her is a movie about a guy who falls in love with his computer. He falls in love with the operating system. And you'll say, well, that's crazy, Omar. I mean, that, you know, that can't happen. And it turns out that he fell in love with her because she displayed uncommon qualities of listening and empathy, which apparently are not predominant in all relationships out there. So, you know, the story ensued. And you'll say, well, come on, you know, artificial intelligence, you know, we get the narrow form, you know, machine learning, pattern recognition stuff. But what about, like, this emotional intelligence? Actually, there's a lot of VC money in the last few years going into artificial emotional intelligence. There are intelligence agencies around the world who will train an infrared camera on your face to study the subcutaneous blood flows and use machine learning and pattern recognition to tell whether or not you're telling the truth. There are other people I'm sure you know about who've got cameras in cars looking at the driver to look at the driver's emotional state to see is it safe to hand back control to the human from the machine. So it's not, the machine doesn't feel what we feel, but it can certainly start to simulate and comprehend a little bit, you know, how we feel things. And if you look at Sophia, the robot from Hanson Robotics, whose skin feels like skin, with all the actuators and motors behind her face, I mean, a conversation with her is kind of a bit weird and freaky because she keeps learning, you know, all the time. And so we'll joke about, you know, the useless voice assistants like Siri, but in reality, they're getting better and better and better. And, you know, Alexa today is showing up in device after device after device. Like, why am I going through all of this? Well, everything I told you about was until very recently considered science fiction, you know, born of the human imagination. But actually, with the application of human ingenuity and human innovation, you know, many of these things start coming closer to our real lives and genuinely impacting, you know who we are as a species, our societies, our business, our economy. And I think that's a huge, huge deal that most people in society haven't yet fully absorbed the implications of it. Now, from a business point of view, it also brings up something else, is these innovations, wherever they emerge, whatever they're in any field, and you know, in implied in what I spoke about there was robotics, machine learning, computer vision, drones, human-computer interfaces, all of those are seeing a logarithmic cost reduction in price. And that means that innovation meets an old business model and causes disruption. And so every disruptive scenario you can see, you will find at the heart of it, someone has innovated a way of doing something that we do better, faster, cheaper than the existing business model. And the problem is the existing business model is glued to the way it does things because that's actually what made it successful. We optimize our core businesses perfectly. The budgets are streamlined. The operating models are cut in the right way. The org structures are set in the right way. So we love doing things the way we do them, and it makes us inflexible in the face of new innovation that causes disruption. And so then you'll say, well, where's all this disruption coming from? I mean, Uber, Tesla, Airbnb, I mean, everyone's heard of those. Those companies were not possible without the cloud. All of those companies have been built on extremely massive, elastic scale, near infinite storage and computing power. And so you then go and look at the cloud companies. And what you'll find is in the last X years, like the last decade, 7 of the 10 biggest market cap companies in the world are technology companies, and you know them all. So, you know, Alibaba, Baidu, Tencent, sorry, not Baidu, and Microsoft, Amazon, Google, Apple, etc. So those companies are super impressive, and we all look at them and we admire them. And I've spent many years working with CXOs and CEOs of companies, and they go and look at these guys and they go, exactly what Paolo said actually is, I want to be like them. You know, I want to be a trillion-dollar company. And in fact, they go further. They say, we're going to be a platform company. And so most business leaders say, we're going to become a platform. But unfortunately, that logic is flawed. It's flawed for several reasons. Firstly, most of the way in which those folks achieved huge network scale economics was in a B2C world, not a B2B world. So it doesn't translate as literally as sometimes, you know, we may think. Secondly, the fact that one of these folks is dominating a particular space means that they are basically unassailable. You know, Amazon, no one's really going to break its gridlock on e-commerce in the US, although Walmart's giving it a good run for the money. In advertising dollars, 98% of Facebook's revenues are advertising, 86% of Google's revenues are advertising. They've been highly disruptive to the traditional agency model. Tencent is 50% plus gaming in its revenues. Alibaba is 50% plus e-commerce. So those guys have got a lock on the markets they're in. And so their model is not really replicable in the same way. And then the final point I'll bring out is their strategies are completely different. They look big and they look tech, but they're completely different companies. Alphabet is about, Alphabet, the parent company of Google, really is the master of data monetization. They figure out how to get data in any which way they can, how to mash data sets, how to enrich data sets, how to govern that data, how to analyze and machine learn and deep learn on that data, and figure out how to make money from that. And they're really good at that in field after field after field. And then they take some of that money and they reinvest that in moonshots. And so we'll see whether or not the moonshots work, you know, Verily in healthcare or Waymo in autonomous vehicle technology and so on. We'll see whether that works. But they've been amazingly successful at data monetization. Amazon is the ultimate disruptor. I mean, they really live, breathe, eat disruption, and they love it. So everyone knows the story about retail. I think many of you have seen e-books, the Kindle, Audible. Like, so they've changed how we consume some types of media. The concept of AWS was basically born because Jeff Bezos said to all their developers that you cannot produce something without a formal API interface, and you're going to expose that interface to the rest of the company. And then they found that the APIs got the most use calls on them were the ones that were most popular, and they would actually use those to promote those services. And those sets of services coming together became AWS, Amazon Web Services, which has been highly disruptive in the field of technology, not just for infrastructure, but if you look at what they're doing at the platform layer around databases, analytics, IoT technology, I mean, their ambitions are massive. And honestly, they've just started. You'll have seen Twitch was an Amazon company, which is e-streaming and e-gaming. I mean, can you believe they paid the kid who won Fortnite, the Fortnite World Games, $3 million. That's more than you get at Wimbledon in tennis for having people watch this kid play Fortnite and win a Fortnite championship. That's an Amazon product in Twitch. And the list goes on. If you look at Prime Air, I mean, I'm amazed by that technology. You know, fleets of vehicles getting out there that launch mega fleets of drones that can deliver things to people's homes with precision. So the whole zone of supply chain and logistics is being fundamentally rethought, re-architected, and redone. And what a lot of people don't realize is that Amazon is busy doing that. They will publish last year's version of their logistics and inventory management software open source. So at one level they're disrupting, and at the other level they're trying to stimulate the markets around them to develop and be creative around them. And so I'm saying that you can't copy the platform companies. I really don't think you can. But we can learn an enormous amount from them. We can learn a lot about their partnership models, how they think about ecosystem. We can learn a lot about innovation and how they make innovation pervasive in their business throughout everything that they do. And if you look closely, what you'll find is Google will take AI technology applied to energy management in the data centers and transform the cost base in their core business of Google Cloud. Microsoft will take some of their latest Bing search technologies and apply it for marketing to SMB, small and medium businesses, of their own products. So using their own technology to market their stuff, to grow their core business. And Amazon, as I said, will take investments out of the retail marketplace and keep pushing them in and suddenly use an API world logic to create AWS and completely scale a brand new business. So they take innovation to transform the core business, to grow the core business, and scale a new business. And that is indeed what we in other ways you could call digital transformation. It's like, how do I take innovation and push that into my core business and find my new growth business to drive my company in the future? And indeed, many industrial companies that you and we serve, you know, have got some of those lessons. And if you look at a Siemens, I remember a few years ago I was negotiating a joint venture with Siemens, and I was surprised when they were explaining to me that half of their engineers are software engineers. They got the logic, and some of that led to MindSphere and a series of other domains that they're in today. And again, we'll see whether or not these things work, but for sure, they're directionally in the right direction. Bosch, with their IoT solutions group, recognizing that if I'm going to have 6 million sensors out there all talking with different communications protocols, and I actually want to embed security at the edge, and if I want to ingest that data and do something meaningful for it to give services to my end customers so that I can do smart parking of the device of a car, or if I want to manage heat and smoke alarms or remote lighting, they build the Bosch IoT Solutions Group. They understood that that's a critical part of their new ecosystem that they have to build to solve customers. And then you have companies like Roche in the life sciences space, who understood the transformation in the world that says, in the old days, I used to design a molecule which might become an oncology product, and then I would ship that molecule wholesale to a hospital, and good luck. In the new world, that doesn't work. I need to capture data. I need to organize a tumor board of doctors where I provide the software that brings all the clinicians and physicians and data scientists together to look at the field trials and the real world trials of what's really happening in hospitals, so I can get a feedback loop back into the design of my molecules in life sciences. And so you'll see Roche go out and acquire a company like Flatiron, which is basically owning the data sets in the oncology space. And there are examples after examples like that that are very, very relevant and meaningful here for you. And when you sort of step back from them and say, I mean, the world of telco that I've been spending a lot of time in recent years, you'll hear a lot about 5G deployments, 5G networks. You'll hear about virtualization of the network. So just what we saw happen to the cloud, where servers became base metal, in other words, dumber, and more of the operation of the cloud servers was done with software, exactly that is happening to cause disruption in the network equipment space, where antennas and base stations and relays become bare metal versions of themselves, and you virtualize the network running it in the cloud as well. And so you'll see the Vodafones, the ATTs, the Verizons, and all these others working to figure out, in that world, yes, I can transform my core business of building and deploying a network, but how do I create brand new services that make me more relevant, for example, in 5G IoT use cases in the industrial sphere for my customers to drive new revenue growth? So everyone is wrestling with this thing of, how do I apply innovation in my core business, and how do I apply innovation to find new revenue streams for growth in the future? And that, in many ways, is what digital transformation is about. I could be very boring and detailed, and in fact, I was very boring and detailed with two colleagues where we co-wrote a book called Pivot to the Future, which is all about the sorts of stories I'm telling you of actually how can you be hyper-relevant to your customers? Like, what does that really look like? Who are the companies that lead that? How do you build an ecosystem of relationships so that your innovation is not just in-house, but it's bringing together a whole network of friendships and alliances and partnerships that you bring to solve your customers' problems? And how can you become more technology-driven? When I grew up in business, we often talked about IT and technology as an enabler. And actually, one of the things I really deeply believe in my core today is that's just wrong. Every company has to be awesome at technology. Otherwise, they're going to just fail. If you don't get a good online app from your bank, you will ultimately get bored and move on. Same with your insurance company, same with any domain we go after. Every company has to be amazing at technology. Unfortunately, this pivot of digital transformation from the core business to the new business over time is really hard. It is tough. Although there are great examples out there, people forget 5 years ago, Microsoft was a boring dinosaur. Today, Microsoft is cool. 5 years ago, Walmart, everyone thought was going to be killed by Amazon. Doug McMillon has turned around Walmart, and it is quite cool. So there are great examples out there of legacy businesses transforming themselves to be relevant in the digital era, but there are some critical lessons. One I touched on is innovation. has to be pervasive in the business. The second one is a scope question. And this is very tough. And like you're going to ask yourself, why am I telling you all of this? But the scope question is, if I, in any given business, I have a scope. And to get from the core to the new, it turns out I need to make massive investments. I mean, Hexagon has transformed itself repeatedly with all the M&A and acquisitions that Norbert and some of the others spoke about earlier. That's a big commitment of investment. It turns out that most big companies are not big enough to manage the investments across their whole scope. They have to make choices of scope. Nokia wrote down all of its smartphone asset technology. It was a big, bold gamble that Satya made early in his tenure. The life sciences companies have done some very similar things. You guys know the automotive sector very, very well. You saw most of them in the last 12 months, they get electrification and they get autonomy, but they're kind of walking away from their investments in mobility. And not completely, but they're basically saying they're not going to be the leader in ride sharing and all the and the ride hailing and all the other apps in that space, because frankly, others people do. They have to make a scope choice in order to target their investments. So there's a lot going on in the world where human imagination sparks human innovation. There are too many examples, actually, of people, scientists and researchers and engineers working on things that they saw in science fiction that have come to bear. Those are often being enabled and powered by the cloud, the huge tech stack, the hyperscaler companies. And there are some great lessons to derive from them, but trying to be one of them is probably not the lesson. And that leads us to think about digital transformation and how we embed innovation in our companies. So then what does that mean for us who are out there in the field engaging with customers? And I mean, I'd like to just reflect on some lessons from my last few years working at Accenture. Accenture, I think many of you will know, grew up at sort of an intersection between management consulting and technology implementation. Now, today, it's a 500,000-person company. In CMT, where it's 100,000 people, we have hundreds of services. The market cap of the company is $120, $130 billion company spread out across the world. So we had to learn a lot of lessons about scaling and particularly the sales cycle. And so a couple of lessons. When we show up at pitches, we too often have things in our head that we're trying to get into the customer's head. And unfortunately, that's a one-directional conversation and almost useless. Because you don't know if that person is having a problem with their kids that morning, or if they're stressed about their job or their promotion, or if they're in love with what Liverpool did to Tottenham at the weekend. Getting into the other person's head is all about listening, and listening not just to the words, but to the unsaid things, to the body language, the cues. It is to be an effective salesperson is about winning that trust. And so that means you're moving away from a world of, you know, the weekly KPI, and, you know, I landed the sale, or, you know, how many RFPs came through the door, to getting to a world of building long-run trust. It's not about transactions. It's about client outcomes. Now, there are a lot of great books written out there on trust and a lot of experiences, but I find very few people say the words, but they often find it very hard to follow through. You know, the metrics don't go in that direction, or, you know, we don't have the collaboration culture, or I don't even know what I don't know. I mean, there's all sorts of great reasons. But at the end of the day, the most successful people understand how to get into the mind and heart of the person sitting opposite them because they actually care about them. And customers can tell if you care or not. And the best salespeople here, and I know you all know this already very well, are people who the customers trust. And I heard a couple of examples earlier of going in there, and if they don't trust you, then go and get with the professor that they do trust. I like that one. So thinking hard about, if I want to get under the skin, then I better understand their industry. I better understand how these innovations could solve their problem. And that's not just about landing a product. It's about landing a solution that probably has to stitch together with some kind of brownfield estate that they already have. They never have a beautiful, clean, greenfield situation. You're dealing with legacy. You're dealing with data quality. You're dealing with a bunch of issues. And so the best salespeople really get to grips with all of that. And then my final point is I think it takes courage. It takes guts to step out of our comfort zones and do things differently from how we did them yesterday. Because, you know, what got me here is what I did yesterday. And what I'm suggesting is it probably won't take you to the next level. So I can see that, is that time left or am I in deficit?
They've reset it. So I'd like to take this conversation broader. Firstly, let's thank Omar for that wonderful spread of more context. Omar Abbosh. Thank you, man.